principal ballerina at London's Royal Ballet for 20 years, Darcy Bustle was one of the world's most famous dancers. But the rigors of classical ballet are a long way from the world she is about to enter.
Say the attraction to those films as an eight-year-old. They were my first real introductions to wanting to dance at all.
4 years after retiring, she's going to attempt to dance in a completely new way. To tap like Fred Astaire. To foxtrot like Ginger Rogers. And to leap like Gene Kelly. But this kind of dancing is the opposite of everything she has been trained to do.
Maybe I am slightly stepping out of my comfort zone. Just a little bit.
She's gotta be crazy. But God love her, if she does it great and I like it, bravo.
Stepping into the shoes of the Hollywood greats, Darcy will discover the story of these films' music, costume design,
the skirt goes with you, look at that,
and famous set pieces. And by dancing them herself, she'll unlock the secret of their genius. Sound came to the movies. Every Hollywood studio developed its own style of musical. And for the next 40 years, huge audiences were enchanted.
Where is it that these movies leave in our hearts? It's some image of brio, sophistication, romance, wit, lyricism, all coming together in this rhythmic current. People like Astaire and Citrice and Ginger Rogers, they're the most watched dancers of all time, and will continue to be so.
The first film musicals were crude. Cameras and microphones had to stay still, so dancing was difficult to capture. But the technology quickly improved. New dance musicals became big box office, and new kinds of stars danced their way to fame.
How they did it, I just don't know. They had great technique. And their musicality, the way they could interpret a piece of music just through their bodies, was fantastic.
Darcy Bustle has always wanted to dance like the performers she grew up watching.
I think it is a little dream that's to imagine that I could ever achieve any of these numbers myself.
Now her moment has come. In 2 weeks' time, she will go before the camera to dance her versions of numbers she has always loved. Moviegoers came to expect and love a range of dances, so Darcy is going to perform four classics. A Fred tap solo. A Fred and Ginger romantic duet. A comic trio from Singing in the Rain, and a complete reinvention of one of the most influential dance numbers ever filmed.
It's ambitious, isn't it?
All of it's ambitious, because of course I've been a ballet dancer for the last 21 more years professionally, and so I haven't had a chance to do many of those other styles. And so, yeah, I hope it's going to be fun. I hope it's not going to be terrifying.
Darcy retired to live in Australia 4 years ago.
Morning, Alex.
Morning.
Now she's returned. It's day one of rehearsals in a dance studio in West London. In just 2 weeks, she must unlearn the ballet techniques she has been trained in since the age of 9 and make her body move in a completely different way.
Well, no, I think whatever we do, we've got to replace ourselves. So wherever the camera is, so if it went...
Helping her, along with two West End dancers, is one of Britain's leading choreographers, Kim Gavin.
Maybe, and hold it.
Like Darcy, Kim trained at the Royal Ballet School.
We're gonna do it in a second anyway.
But he made his name in commercial choreography, producing show-stopping numbers for Take That, among many others.
We're paying tribute to 4 classic scenes and adapting them for ourselves. We're exploring, you know.
Sorry.
It's very much an exploration of that era and how difficult the routines were.
First, Darcy will be attempting the iconic putting on the Ritz. The number poses 3 main technical difficulties. Darcy will have to learn a whole new way of using her feet, of holding her body, and using props, all within an extremely complex rhythm.
When you watch Fred Astaire doing Putting on the Ritz, my brain understands how difficult it is, but my heart understands how gorgeous it is just to watch it. And that's what great dancing's all about.
Fred Astaire himself said that rehearsing this solo took 5 weeks of back-breaking physical work.
Suddenly, he goes through that glass door, and there they are, an army of friends. Just unbelievable.
I think with Putting on the Ritz, apart from being a classic piece, you look at it and go, how did they do that? And then when you're in a rehearsal room, it's much more of a realisation once you've actually put it on your own body.
But it's not so taking...
I'm going.
Yeah. But you're thinking more that the stick is kind of there, and what a surprise.
Controlling in the move.
Yeah.
Ballet is all about effort and holding a leg as high as you can, or the turnout, keeping your feet pointed all the time. And I think that what the big jump is to the styles that we're doing is more about feel and being relaxed.
Just relax your feet, be sloppy with your feet a bit more.
It's very difficult to be sloppy.
No, but you're almost pointing your feet between each shuffle. I want you to dance like that.
I want you to walk around like that.
It's not about having a stiff back, having turnout, having poise and strength.
One last time from the top.
It's about relaxing into the thing and expressing yourself within it. And I think that's the difference with Darcy. I mean, I think it's about the tap and the rhythms and making it smooth, but it's not about the effort that you put in that she would do if she did a ballet. Tap teaches you things that lots of ballet people never know. You're thinking percussively and you're thinking down. Ballet is simply an art of the aerial going up. If you're doing tap, you're going down into the floor. You've got to think hard. You've got to think of making a noise rather than never making a noise. And there's extraordinary speed with the feet. And of course, a ballet dancer moves fast with the foot, but they're using the foot in a different way. They're very seldom going to be bringing down the heel that often. When they move fast with the feet, they're normally covering ground in a very different way from the way tap dancers are. So there is Fred going brrrr in ways that I can't even analyze.
Any ballet dancer is just going to have to think of the whole musculature from the hip down in a whole new way. Fred's special skill was to make everything he did look natural and make every extraordinary movement look like everyone could do it if they just chose to. And that's quite a skill. I would imagine if without a massive experience it's extremely difficult. It feels like it's something that maybe you need to have been doing all your life, you know, and it's sort of integral to the way you move. So that's difficult.
Fred Astaire rehearsed every single routine for weeks before he was satisfied. But Darcy only has a fortnight to rehearse 4 routines, and tap was forbidden at ballet school because it was thought that it weakened dancers' ankles.
1, 2, 3. Tap dancing is something I suppose I've always been very passionate about, watching the films, and it is incredibly exciting to watch. 1, 2, 3. And it'd be nice to think that, you know, I could achieve some of that excitement.
That's all right.
Did the first bit right.
And again? 1, 2.
Both Nathan Clark and Dougie Mills are experts in tap.
I need to turn there. Sorry. I'm too old, aren't I? It's my problem. 1, 2, 3.
When you watch most tap dancers, their hands and arms are basically just hanging there. With Fred Astaire, everything is used. Okay, his feet are gone, but so are his arms and so are his hands.
Astaire's style of the upper body, which is not that of any other tap dancer, this way of making a line throughout the body, making shapes, so you really are turning a technique into style, physical style. Extraordinary.
And the way he uses the cane, the way the cane is used, is extra rhythm throughout. It's as though he's got 3 legs.
Hey! That's it, Goff.
Fred Astaire wasn't just a dancer, he was a drummer and a pianist. There are recordings of him doing all these things. If you see him in a wonderful movie where he has a jazz number with a drum set, and you see him in one take with his feet playing the drums as well as his hands, and it's great music, and it's great dancing.
My first rehearsal day after about 3 years.
How was it?
It feels all lovely now because you're so hot and sweaty that you can't feel a thing. I'm just conscious of what it's going to feel like when I wake up in the morning. My body, it's not used to this anymore. This nerve stretch.
Don't rush. 1, 1, stay down.
Darcy has come to ask for advice from a man who has already brought Fred's style to modern audiences by fusing it with ballet.
And show it. 1.
Derek Dean.
Fast, 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 fast. Good. 1.
He is rehearsing the English National Ballet in his production of Strictly Gershwin, in which Darcy's tap mentor, Dougie Mills, is co-starring.
And down. Sharp, 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 sharp. 1, 1. That's good. Come in, Wolsey. Okay.
Well, Fred Astaire was obviously, you know, the greatest dancer that ever lived, really, wasn't he?
I know, and he wasn't even that good looking, was he?
No, not even that good looking.
Just shows you anybody
true,
can do it.
But what enormous charisma. And if you look at all those old films, the energy levels are enormous. They make it all look terribly easy. They make it all look terribly simple. But your energy levels have to be at full blast to be able to show that.
I have to say, I'm a bit scared.
Well, I don't think you should be. It's about how. It's about where the eyes are going. It's about where the head is going. Is the boy behind? There's so much...
You're giving me so many tips.
There's so much luggage there that makes it look right.
Mm-hmm. You're taken more in by the dance.
Oh, the style.
And the style, yeah. And the way he moved. And the most simple step made it look...
Absolutely.
Extraordinary.
I think you're very brave to do this. I think you're very brave. I think it's a great challenge for you to try and do it. But, you know, what they had was invention, musicality, style. So you obviously have to be able to create what they first developed, which is not impossible at all, but very, very hard, because it was so set on that those people. Do you know what I mean?
As we said, their characters.
Yeah, their characters and how they were.
I it scares me to even think that I'm trying to attempt it, but then I'm also very excited at the same time.
Yeah, of course. And it's a challenge for you. It's a challenge for you.
Yeah.
You know, you're going out of your comfort zone as well.
I think you're
going
to find this very amusing, I know.
Dougie Mills and Paul Robinson, two of the company's stars, have been inspired by the history of tap.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the other one, sorry. We normally do that.
Are you serious?
Yeah, we have to do the toilet.
We normally flip, but we're the other way. We always miss that, though.
Kind of just trying to touch on the history of tap and where it really started. Can you give me any ideas or your inspirations of where tap inspired you?
It was Fred Astaire, you know, and Gene Kelly. That was my earliest
inspiration, isn't it? I go back in even maybe I think maybe only 10 years or something before that to two people that really impressed me. The Nicholas brothers were so acrobatic and their feet were amazing. And I know it's the brother thing, how in sync they were with each other. You know,
they could feed off each other.
Yeah. And I think they started the whole role of film, which moved into Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly. And so that was definitely, I'm sure you agree, our inspiration. We're trying to do it the best justice possible.
Exactly.
You know? So,
major respect.
Yeah, absolutely.
But give me some tips of what kind of hits you straight away if you think about putting on the Ritz. What's your first image?
I would say fluidity with a cane. Being so fluid.
Ease, yeah.
You know, where he just moves the cane,
and the cane
just is so in sync with his body, and then the way he moves it around his body and stuff, it's just like...
See, the cane is my partner. The style with Fred Astaire's stick and positioning and all those shoulder moves, and I've got a lot to think about. But it's all about rehearsal, and if I go over it, I think Ali also mentions the stick and having that relationship with the stick, that it actually is your partner, that Fred Astaire used that stick as part of his moves, that it wasn't just an added-on prop. Worries me a bit as well, but I'll just have to take it to bed with me. That doesn't sound right, does it?
We know what you mean.
I'll just sleep on it. I'll have to sleep. That doesn't sound right either. That sounds awful.
Musicals were big business for a year after the coming of sound. But then the depression hit Hollywood hard. One studio, RKO, even faced bankruptcy. But then a dance musical with a performer new to movies called Fred Astaire became a surprise hit. Fred's skills in the theatre had attracted the interest of Hollywood producers relatively late. He was 34 by the time he made his first films in 1933.
He and his sister, Adele, had been performing
on stage in vaudeville, later on Broadway and here in London, from the ages of 5 and 7. He and Adele had done a screen test back in the 20s, and there's a famous quote attributed to an anonymous studio executive, which is, "Can't act, can't sing, balding also dances."
Before sound, a man who looked like Fred would never have been a star. But Fred's dancing and singing made him one of the biggest names of the 1930s and saved RKO itself from ruin. He took inspiration from wherever he could find it. For tap, he borrowed dance styles he saw in 1920s Harlem. In this case, given an innovative treatment within a bygone tradition of the minstrel show.
Well, from the 20s onwards, tap meeting ballroom, this is the great confluence, and it was happening partly with the black African-American artists, but partly with the high age of 20s, 30s elegance also. So it's the overlap of both white and black eras of society. Plenty of people feel that tap belongs to black artists and that Fred Astaire was an interloper. For me, he's as great a tap dancer as there ever was.
I just like to go from the beginning again. Sorry.
It's day 3 of the putting on the Ritz rehearsals. Darcy now has to put together the moves, the cane work, and the tapping. And Darcy's knee, which went through major ligament surgery 5 months ago, is holding up well, so far.
She's recovering from the knee injury, which is hard on, you know, especially the tap is hard because you're completely pounding on one knee. I think she's certainly got guts.
She snapped a tendon in the knee called the anterior cruciate ligament. She must adapt her dancing accordingly.
I was doing some dance classes just for fun, and I landed from a jump, and I dislocated my knee. And I had to go and see a physio surgeon that day, and they said that I had snapped it. And I said, but I know, I've seen dancers snap Achilles and ACLs, and it goes off like a gunshot. Yeah. And I said, there was no sound. And he said, well, probably because of your career, there wasn't much of a tendon left anyway, because I have had 2 operations on the same leg on my ankle. So basically, they cut your hamstring and they graft it on with 2 screws. Normally, wouldn't dance on it probably until 8 months after the operation. So what I mustn't do on it is jump. Any large jumps, I can do small jumps. But if you have a choreographer that knows you, you can adapt. At least it was my other knee.
1, 2.
The next day, Darcy's family arrived to give moral support.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Angus.
Thank you. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Nice to see you.
How are you?
Oh, sweaty, sorry.
Are you going to do a little run for us?
You don't know.
Her husband, Angus, is worried about the physical toll the rehearsals are taking.
Just sit down.
How's your knee?
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
The, I'd miss this. Oh, my God, so bad.
And then keep moving straight away.
Don't stop.
Mummy was really good. When you're older, you're going to be like Mummy. Singing. Do you want to be a dancer as well?
I would like to be a dancer.
So you can be dancing and singing, can't you? So you can be used to work hard like Mummy. She works hard, doesn't she? Exactly. So you just work hard, and Mummy can teach you everything she knows about dance. How about that?
She has.
She taught you everything already. Tap isn't Darcy's strongest suit, so she has to work very hard to get to 6, 7, 8 out of 10 by her standards. Plus, having had the ACL on her knee only 5 months ago, this is right borderline. I mean, Darcy's very careful, but we are at the minimum threshold of what she would normally do. So, we've got our fingers crossed. We've really got our fingers crossed that she will get through this program.
Hurt so much now.
It is odd doing it in my 40s and not used to being old and the recovery period after each day being really tough. So I have sort of bowed down to that my body's just going to hurt for the next 3 weeks. Hi, is this Studio 2, please? Great, thank you.
The music Darcy will dance to is being recorded specially for her at the legendary Abbey Road Studio 2. The Beatles, among others, famously used this studio. And now conductor John Wilson is here, recording music that is otherwise only available in the original mono. John Wilson's sell-out proms and concerts of Hollywood classics are attracting new audiences to this music.
So it's not the letter I with the pickup from the clarinet. Oh, this is Darcy. Hello.
Hello.
Should be welcome. We're just about to try and do this nicely for you.
He has assembled a 63-piece orchestra dedicated to recording this music faithfully for the first time since these movies were made.
Yeah. One, two, one, two. Okay, we'll do that as an edit, that section.
For me, slower. Because I'm not attacked up. I'm pretending. Okay.
That's a good one for the violin lines, I'm told. Have you gone and have a listen to it, yeah?
Shock. Not that I wasn't expecting it to be good, but it's slightly too professional for me.
John has made it his mission accurately to recreate music that was once thought lost forever.
In 1969, MGM was taken over. And the room full of scores and all the orchestral parts was destroyed. one Saturday morning. Every note of music written for every MGM film was taken away and used as landfill for a golf course, so that music no longer exists. So I had no choice other than to transcribe them from the soundtrack. But it's music I've loved all my life, and for the past decade I've been restoring this music by listening to the soundtracks. And laborious though that may be, one is restoring great works of American popular culture. Alright, I know how to fix that. And they're as fresh now to listen to, especially live, as they were when they were first recorded. One, two, two, two.
It's really impressive. And seeing them all kind of furiously getting in every note, and I feel incredibly honoured, actually. It sort of wants me to make it even more perfect. And I'm not going to be satisfied unless it is.
Just the last toe heel, and into the nine, because we haven't got a clean one yet.
In these movies, the sound of the taps was added separately. Unusually, Fred always did his own, and Darcy comes to what's known as a Foley studio to try to do the same.
Can I do that again?
One more. Just same place.
With the music and the taps in the can, and barely a fortnight after arriving in London, it's Darcy's first film studio day.
I'm not limping. Alright. Morning, Darcy.
Bye.
You're going to push in there,
aren't you? Once the people bring it in front of you.
Nathan Clark, having helped coach Darcy, will now be filling in as the army of Freds after she goes through the mirrors.
Have fun, enjoy, and cool music.
Thank you.
body's feeling like it used to feel, a bit beaten up, but I feel really honored that I got to actually work on that choreography and just appreciate what a genius Fred Astaire was. Probably didn't give him the justice he should have had in putting on the Ritz, but I'm really glad I attempted it. Got a couple of blisters in my tap shoes for a change instead of my point shoes.
Everyone loves tap dancing. Problem is with tap dancing, it's a thing you have to do basically on your own. It's an individual thing. And people want to dance to meet the opposite sex. That's what dancing was all about. Boy meets girl, girl meets boy. That's what you wanted.
For Darcy's second number, she has to move into a very different type of dance, the romantic duet. Darcy has come to one of the last remaining ballrooms in Britain. These dance styles were once all the rage.
My dad, who used to go dancing a lot, has spoken to me about everyone went dancing. Everyone. Everyone wanted to dance because you all wanted to be Fred Astaire or Ginger Rogers. They would watch the movies and see a little move and then they would try and interpret that. My dad used to say he used to practice with his sister in the front room. Oh, let's try and do that thing Fred and Ginger did. And they would practice it. And then when he'd get to the ballroom, get a girl and then give it a go.
The dances that swept Britain were directly influenced by the Hollywood Dream Factory. And when RKO paired an at first reluctant Fred with a certain Ginger Rogers, the most enduring and celebrated duo in dance was formed. Of the hundreds of films RKO made, the Astaire Rogers pictures were among its most profitable.
Well, you know, a lot of the dances that are ballroom dances actually come from America. The foxtrot, that's a Hollywood dance. The quick step comes from the Charleston. So that's another dance that comes from America and has developed into one of our ballroom dances. And I think when people went to the cinema, they wanted to be Astaire and Ginger Rogers.
The duo changed not just Hollywood, but how couples on both sides of the Atlantic danced. Dances from their films became crazes, such as the hit of 1934, The Continental. Retro DJs, the Shellac Sisters, play these very records today.
And would this have first come off a film?
Yes, because people saw the dancing, Fred and Ginger doing amazing things, and probably thought, if I get hold of that 78, you know, me and the wife could learn those steps and then we'd wow them on the dance floor.
It's quite a fashion, the Continental, because you tell them you love what you dance. Your lips whisper so tenderly, but I answer you sad. But it's quite the Continental.
Why do you think it became a craze?
I think the Continental was a bit risque, wasn't it? It's a kiss in the middle. And that would have been quite unusual to do that in public.
In that time.
In that time, yeah. So to have a dance where that was part of the dance.
It was allowed.
Yeah.
It was a boys' dance. It was choreographically allowed.
Yeah, exactly.
Now I can see.
Sure, all the men rushed to the dance studios to learn that one.
Can you imagine the queues outside?
Yeah. So yeah, because yeah, in that era, it would be very undone.
Some dances were brief crazes, but other Fred and Ginger numbers have endured forever. In her version of Cheek to Cheek from the movie Top Hat, Darcy will be taking the Ginger Rogers role.
I wonder what's keeping Horace.
It's always a question with dancing all the time, how much is it about sex?
I'm afraid I'm going to have a headache.
Oh, don't go. This is a meeting I've been planning a long time.
There's a famous thing that Katharine Hepburn, though, is meant to have said, that Ginger gave him sex and he gave her class.
It's nice to see you again, Mr. Tremont.
You robbed me of the pleasure of introducing you two. You've already met.
The chemistry between him and Ginger was never equaled ever again.
Physically, they were such perfect complements that both very lissom, very lithe. She was just the right body shape to match his slight figure. And it's a very good example of how they told a story in dance. Very much part of their characters, their thought processes, their feelings, all of which their wonderful fluency of movement communicates. Watching this as a kid on Sunday afternoons, this probably would have been one of my favourite pieces. Cheek to cheek. That's very romantic. I do love the feel. She looks like she's totally studying Fred. She's got her eye on him all the time. And he looks like he's just playing with the steps.
Techniques in this style of dancing are also very different from ballet. Here, Darcy will have to go against her instinct to keep her knees straight and her feet turned out. And she'll have to allow her posture to relax.
It looks so easy, but it actually isn't at all. Rehearsing it, it's actually really tiring because they bounce all the way through it. They're doing a lot of jumps. Even the steps are so simple. Favorite bit is the end, and then cheek to cheek, it suddenly just all makes sense. And he really pushes his face against hers. She seems a bit kind of tense. Quite lovely. And the relief that they finished.
This image of romance has a powerful appeal across the decades. 2 years ago, Darcy was a guest judge on Strictly Come Dancing.
Hi, Maura, lovely to see you.
Lovely to see you. Welcome back.
I know. It brings back a lot of good memories, actually. It's really nice. I love the new sets as well.
Oh, good.
No, it's very impressive.
For us, with Strictly, the likes of Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, they are the benchmark for dance. It's about the coupling, it's about the chemistry. That's who Len will set as a benchmark for everybody to aspire to be.
That's what I want to see. That's what I want to be transported to Hollywood. And whether I'm stuck here in Shepherd's Bush, I still want to be there in Hollywood, thinking of Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers.
We're working on four different pieces. One piece is Cheek to Cheek, which was Fred Astaire. Yeah. Would you have any tips for me approaching a piece like that?
I mean, I know it's Foxtrot, it's about being
It's very fluid, very fluid and smooth. So I would say, because it's so also linear,
yeah.
But the lines are also very smooth going in and out. So no tension in the body. It has to have some kind of tension, but it has to be a very fluid, relaxed.
It's actually hit me.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
That's brilliant. Yes. Thank you very much. You're welcome. Well, all the best for tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah. Enjoy.
They don't hit it, do they?
No.
I wish you didn't have that bloody dress on.
I can see it that more.
This time, Nathan will be taking the Fred Astaire role.
Just do it. This is a bit of a challenge working with a ballerina because you have completely different training and the way you hold your body is different and the way ballet boys partner their girls is a lot different to the way that we're trained.
Is it because I'm trying to go, yeah... Yeah, and it's...
Rather than going... So I haven't done the classical training with partners, but I know that it's a lot more controlled and rigid, and you know exactly where everything is. Where when it comes to partner work and the jobs that I do, it's literally throw that girl around as fast as you can and just hope that you get there in time. I think Darcy's done an amazing job of coming over to my side of things, and I've also learnt a lot from her.
5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 115, 116, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, 124
swing from the hip. It's all about the... They're called the swing dances because you swing through the hip. In addition to that, you have to get sway. These things are not natural in a ballet dancer. When you watch ballroom dancing, the first step is taken through the heel, and then you lift up onto the ball of your foot to get rise and fall. Same in the foxtrot. Heel, ball, rise and fall. In ballet, you very rarely, in fact, I don't know if ever, you step forward through the heel. It's always off the ball of the foot or through the toe onto the ball. So this is going to be technically a huge challenge.
Yeah.
Apart from just learning the choreography and getting the number down, the technique is going to be so difficult and so far out of Darcy's comfort zone.
You seem to kind of glide on, but then he pulls you down.
It's more of that.
Yeah.
And I'm doing like a grungy on
top. Yeah.
Like a ballet step.
Marcus and Karen Hilton are 12 times champion ballroom dancers. They've come to give Darcy some technical tips about how this sort of dance style differs from what she's been brought up to do.
Quite slow though, isn't it? You know, it seems like a check to the left and right, then it comes back.
So it's sort of doing a triangle. Is that right?
Because it's almost like a check. Back, we call it a natural check.
If I look at a male and female in the ballet world, the male will just literally support the female, whereas in this instance, they're actually body weights are coming together. So it's the weight of the body that's sort of supporting each other.
So we've got that constant body weight contact and yeah. weight contact.
It's quite soft, isn't it?
It's yeah. much softer.
Very soft.
We were just going side and side. Side. And it's like a cross.
I think the challenge is tremendous, but she's coping admirably because from an early age, Darcy's been told she must straighten those knees no matter what.
Flex your knees. Does it chase up to me? Just feel how flex my knees are. They never ever
straighten.
We're talking about flex knees, we're talking about knees inside, edge of knees, coming inside, no turnout, tracking of the legs under the body.
Put your knee together, at the back of your knee.
Yes.
But she's making a lovely job of it and I know she's capable of doing it beautifully.
Nice.
Straight.
technique, Darcy needs to find out what was the essential character that Ginger Rogers brought to this extraordinary dance partnership. Actress Summer Strallon is about to play the Ginger Rogers part in a new national touring production of Top Hat.
Obviously, she was a beautiful lady.
Tiny.
And a fantastic actress. I think that's the main thing that I love about her. She wasn't the most fantastically trained technical dancer, yet she looks it. There's a meaning to every single move that she does.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can really tell kind of what she's thinking the whole way through.
She's telling a story of her moves.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, that's been a massive inspiration to me anyway, watching her work.
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 2.
Ginger Rogers was essentially an amateur.
1, 2, 3, 1.
Glorious amateur, I should say, because she almost watched her learn to dance through each film. She learned from Stair and she got better and better as it went along. The pleasure in watching her is watching this person who's loving it, absolutely loving doing what she's doing and loving getting better at it. And it's partly why we all love Strictly Come Dancing, actually. We love seeing those people get better each week and we love that sort of change and how they feel about it. And it's a lot to do with feeling, I think. So that would be my advice, really, is to try and capture that, not just the technique.
The success of Fred's films attracted some of the top popular composers of the day to work with him.
Nice and lightly, yeah?
And Irving Berlin's Cheek to Cheek was one of the most lasting numbers of them all.
These movies often prompted the musicians to their finest. Irving Berlin had been at the top of show business since the First World War or thereabouts, but he'd actually gone to slight loss of inspiration. Suddenly he's invited to work on Top Hat, and working for Fred Astaire brings his greatest flowering so far. Fred Astaire was a sort of quality control man when it came to certain composers. He'd be known to say, I think you can do better. He was tireless in polishing it to a real perfection. The sort of perfection I don't think we'll ever see again. The way Fred Astaire put a number across was often, you know, very much involved with his rhythmic sense. He never thought of himself as a singer, but he was many composers' favourite singer. He always sang beautifully in tune, and he had this sort of poise and rhythmic sort of grace, which I think did a lot of those numbers great credit and great justice.
Madge doesn't care, I certainly don't.
Neither do I. All I know is that it's heaven. I'm in heaven. And my heart beats so that I can hardly speak. And I seem to find the happiness I see. When we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
The phrase that Fred Astaire brings is so astounding. I love the way he slides the voice generally. And da 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 da. It's really a master musician portamento effect. That.
Seem to vanish like a gambler's lucky streak. When we're out together dancing cheek to cheek.
While rehearsing, Darcy gets a special visitor.
Rehearsing cheek to cheek.
A swell tune.
A swell tune.
A swell tune. It's the perfect vernacular for the time.
As a teenager, Ava Astaire traveled frequently with her father.
Daddy and Ginger were, they never fought. I mean, there's always all these stories about how they were fighting constantly. And I really think that probably can be attributed to the dress that he had to fight when they did the number cheek to cheek. They got out there to do the shot and the feathers started shedding and they got up his nose and in his eyes and he lost his temper. And from that, legends have been built that they fought constantly. But actually, when the whole filming was over, they presented her with a gold feather for her charm bracelet. Oh, so
but it is one of those magical pieces when you watch Cheek to Cheek, because you just go, that dress, oh my gosh, that dress.
I can see why she wanted it, and she did design it, and it's just that they never rehearsed with those dresses. Any of the costumes, and they never did in those days.
So, and there you are, the feathers down low there.
Couturier to the stars, and one of Princess Diana's favorite dress designers, Bruce Oldfield is giving advice about the type of frock Darcy might wear.
That dress, on its own, is a dog. And that dress needs a body in it, and it needs a body who's dancing, because it's this great big bulky coat.
She was so petite, to put her in something that kind of covered her up.
Yeah, it was ridiculous. I mean, but, of course, it was a sublime dress in motion, a ghastly yeti of a frock.
I've never seen somebody faff around with a dress that's in their mouth, and she was like, ugh. And every time she went upside down, you couldn't see her face.
Yeah.
So he would lunge with her, and the dress would be like that, flapped over her face. It must have been...
Well, apparently, after that film, she was called Feathers. That was her nickname.
Oh.
Yeah.
Amazing. So, can we look at a feel...
A feel of feathers,
Cheek to cheek. Cheek to cheek, not cheek to cheek.
Yeah, it just needs flow at the hem, doesn't it? You know, what about this one? Because this one has... You know, it's massively, there's a lot of dress there. This is a wedding dress, I
And of course, if you danced in that, it would just keep moving after you.
Yeah.
It's very short. I've got such a long body.
Oh, well, you might come out the top end as well.
Thank you.
That wouldn't do. Hello. Does it do up?
I don't know.
Ooh, ginger. Ginger.
Is it because I've got to lower it because of my waist actually?
I think it is, but then your boobs might jump out the top. That'll be exciting.
No, it won't be.
Yeah, it looks great.
And it is, it's so light, it doesn't feel like it would knock anybody out.
Right? No, playing Fred.
We're all
Fred.
Yeah, exactly. But there's enough room under here for a couple of people, though, isn't there?
Yeah, I don't know.
You might get lost. That's beautiful.
It's good also for your high kicks if you decided you wanted to do any.
The skirt goes with you, look at that.
God, it went all the way up your leg.
Oh, it still does.
I'm amazed that your leg will go up that far.
That's very kind.
I didn't know that's where they're supposed to go.
Oh, really?
No.
Downstairs, Bruce has another possibility.
Oh, wow.
Because it's the same as the pink.
I love it.
And
it's lovely seeing it in the making as well.
Like, yeah.
The detail.
I think it'll be very good for that scene.
Gorgeous.
Gorgeous, tell your auntie. What is it, Baz? What's the matter?
Like the dress.
No, it does. It's better in pink.
Yeah, it's better in pink. Why are you making another one? It's gorgeous. Thank you.
A week later, the Bruce Oldfield dress has arrived for a tryout.
Oh, it's a bit big.
Yeah, it could do with coming in a little bit.
The whole point of that cheek-to-cheek thing is that it feels like it's floaty, fantasy, feathery thing.
Floating around your face.
Yeah.
No. It's a little bit too structured, I think, that's why.
So it would take away from the
steps.
All I've got is back, and that completely negates
the back.
I like seeing the back.
Interesting.
That's really the elegant
cool.
part, isn't it?
I mean, that it does look beautiful, but
it's pretty in the punch. But it's not a dress, I suppose, that you twiddle in.
So, the Oldfield dress, not so flexible in the back, is rejected in favour of something closer to the original. Cheek to Cheek is being filmed on location, and her new dress awaits her.
This is the original dress that Darcy tried on. There's been a few alterations to it. We've put more feathers around the bottom, just to give it a bit more weight. Darcy felt like there should be more feathers around her head and shoulders. This has been shaken within an inch of its life, so we don't get any featherage.
Take first positions and cue music.
'50s, MGM was making half of all the musicals turned out by Hollywood, and emboldened by success, the studio took the gamble of allowing one of its stars, Gene Kelly, to co-direct a movie. Kelly jumped in with both feet and helped change the direction of movie musicals forever.
It's 1:30 already, it's morning!
Every person, when they wake up, should have good morning suddenly come on.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We've talked the whole night.
The third number that Darcy will be dancing is from one of Kelly's finest achievements, the ever popular movie Singing in the Rain.
It's great to stay up late.
In Good Morning, she'll take the Debbie Reynolds role.
When you compare Fred Astaire to Gene Kelly, Gene Kelly is more obviously handsome and hunky, and for that very reason, that is apparent sexiness, plenty of people will always prefer Gene Kelly.
Good morning to you and you and you and you.
If Fred Astaire is champagne and caviar, then Gene Kelly was beer and a burger. Yeah, he was the man's dancer.
The same old things are said about Fred and Jean all the time, is that Astaire was elegant and in top hat and tails, and Gene Kelly is the workman-like, you know, everyman guy. You know, he was happy being a builder or a sailor and everything. The irony of it is that I think it was almost the opposite. You know, Astaire fell into the sort of top hat and tails, didn't really feel comfortable. It was much more of a casual kind of guy. Gene Kelly was very sort of inspired by different forms of dance and did look to higher things in terms of his dancing. You know, would wanted to make a whole film using classical ballet dancers, and you know, and you have to admire his ambition.
Darcy will have not only to tap and use props, but also to follow the Gene Kelly trademark use of different levels.
I think this piece has great energy, it's got great wit. You know, I wanted to see Darcy really have fun with it. And I think that that combination all over the set with the levels would be a great challenge for her too.
And good morning. Settees, Macintoshes, anything you wanted. Whatever was lying about almost, let's augment that into the number.
It's just such a unique bit because Gene uses all these props as part of his choreography. And props terrify me.
Eight, four, five, six, seven, eight.
Halfway through rehearsals, and Gene Kelly's daughter, Kerry Kelly Novick, has come to watch.
Hi, I'm Darcy.
I'm Kerry.
Thank you so much for coming.
I'm very happy to be here.
Hi, I'm Kim. Glad to meet you, Kim. And this is Nathan. Hello, Nathan. So we make a cut there.
Gene Kelly had such an athletic body. I suppose that's why he loved all the props and didn't worry about jumping off anything. But she had 40. To go for it. Well, he did Good Morning. He was 40.
Yeah.
Okay, now that feels so bad.
He was
40. Well, there's a parallel.
Yeah, the
found that. Did you watch this piece on the set when they did it?
Yeah, because Singing in the Rain was shot in the summer, so I was on summer vacation, so I was hanging out a lot.
Okay.
I was 8.
It's amazing what you remember, though, isn't it?
And Debbie Reynolds was 18, so I thought she was just the most wonderful person, and she was extremely sweet.
Singing in the Rain, do you have any memory? Did he tell you what that was like to rehearse that? Doing all those dance moves in the rain?
They rehearsed it without the rain a lot, but then it took them 2 days to shoot, and he was wearing a gray tweed suit with a Norfolk jacket, big heavy suit, and it's California in the summer, and the rainwater was sort of tepid, I think, and by the end of the first day, he was running a temperature of 103 and getting pneumonia because he was in the wet suit all day. He shot it really sick.
Well, he did do it.
Yeah, of course.
Singing in the Rain was co-directed by Gene Kelly and Stanley Donen. Now 87, he's lost none of his bite.
Singing in the Rain was a movie that you found yourself collaborating on. What was it like?
Hell! Who could like co-directing? I don't want to have to
prove myself to my partner, and he outweighed me because he was the star of the picture. It said Gene Kelly. I was the director, at least that was my feeling, and Gene was the star. But he was the co-director, and I hated it.
Did you co-choreograph?
Yes.
And was that equally difficult?
Worse. Yes. Because that's very physical. Not something I enjoyed, and I don't think it was something he enjoyed.
Obviously, if no matter where that balance is, unless you're all taking the weight off the back foot
at the same time,
just keep the pressure going. Find where it is.
Yeah.
Go.
It's not fun making movies. Even they're supposed to be about fun. It ain't laughs and joy and isn't this great. It's not. It's tough. It was inch by inch. It's, oh, this is good enough for a few seconds or a few bars. Now what? And you have to come up with a new idea to carry on.
There you go. Boom.
It was a step-by-step idea. It works up to there, but now it seems to be lousy. How? What's wrong? Take it out, change it, turn it upside down. And so that's the way it is to choreograph that particular number. It's not, it doesn't, the only idea behind that number is they're happy dancing together. And, happy dancing is not a great idea. We've all seen it a lot. So you have to come up with great invention. I don't know if it was great, but it was at least invention. You see, In the Rain was also step by step in that If you look at it, you'll see him dancing and splashing in puddles. Well, those puddles have to be selected, the beat they're on, how big it is, how much water it is, where does he go, and they have to be dug out of the cement. It's inch by inch. It's not, oh, I've got a great idea, he's going to splash in the puddles. Now what? You know, you have to work out exactly which puddle, how does he splash in it, where is it, what's the dance step, how does it fall in the music. Well, that's choreographing.
Dancing and singing in the rain.
Fred Astaire had not gone away. In fact, he returned with a vengeance in this movie, discovering in the process a whole new range of invention.
This is from a film, Bandwagon, which I think is one of my most favourite scenes from some of these films, because the choreography is just extraordinary, actually quite comical, but just perfectly, perfect for the scene, because it's all set in a nightclub. There's all these gangsters and they're girls.
Fred Astaire also found a brand new partner, the extraordinary Sid Charisse.
Sid Charisse plays these two women, the major, sultry woman. Here she comes in her beautiful red dress. It's very sexy, but kind of classy and sexy.
Sid Charisse is my favourite. She was so tall. She had such an elegance, such a presence about her. It's incredible to think that that was done in 53. We're talking over 50 years ago, and yet it's modern. It's up to date. It could be a Michael Jackson number. Smooth Criminal. That is one of my iconic numbers, mainly because it's totally unexpected. It's not what you expect Fred Astaire to be doing.
Astaire is now in his 50s. He was a workaholic, a perfectionist. Didn't love to give it, he wanted to keep it on going, just in the right circumstances, and he needed the right partner.
In Darcy's final number, she'll be exploring the Sid Charisse role in The Girl Hunt from The Bandwagon.
He was inspired by Sid Charisse, who had come from the classical ballet world, but interestingly, really blossomed in film. Apparently, she'd never had any stamina at all. You know, it suited her perfectly to just do these shots and then have a rest and do something else. But she's one of the most beautiful dancers ever captured on screen, and probably one of the most viewed dancers of all time. Fred Astaire in his memoirs talks about Sid Charisse, and he says, when you've danced with Sid Charisse, you stayed danced with.
Hi, Lavelle. Thank you so much for coming to meet me.
The pleasure's mine.
Come and sit down.
Darcy has come to meet choreographer Lavelle Smith Jr., who was a dancer in Michael Jackson's Smooth Criminal video.
I know, right there. That was me. See how that man dancing?
No.
Man fighting dancing.
That wasn't bad. That was great.
Which itself paid direct homage to the Girl Hunt number.
Do you remember watching that with Michael Jackson, that scene with Fred Astaire?
I remember watching it and just thinking, wow, because when I started watching with him, he would explain that he would go to this guy's house, this guy Fred Astaire's house, and learn how to tap.
Really?
Talk about making movies. Yeah, he said that Fred Astaire told him that they took their time. They didn't skimp on that. He'll do it again and again. And that was Michael. I mean, you would have to just smile in there, because we would do it until our bodies told us what was next.
What I notice when you see Michael Jackson's work and Fred Astaire's is that it's very clean, and everything, you can actually see everything, every movement left behind, you know.
Yeah.
I always say like a sparkler when you do this, and you can see the line after it's finished, you know. Yeah. In the movie, and everything's so clean, and as you said, I suppose it does come down to rehearsal.
Smooth Criminal took 3 months to do.
3 months.
And someone reminded me this morning that it was really only 8 minutes.
Wow. Oh well, there you go. That we'll never forget it.
Influence continues. this age and beyond. In this final number, Kim Gavin is reinventing the girl hunt sequence from The Bandwagon for Darcy.
This section from Bandwagon called the Girl Hunt Ballet has riddled its way up to today. And what we want to try and do is take it and do our version of, with Darcy being the forefront, the Sid Charisse character. And sort of put a new soundtrack, new dance, bring in some ensemble to kind of create a dynamic piece based on or influenced by Bandwagon. I'm hoping that we can surround her with a great team as well, and that she's part of that team, unlike the other numbers, which are very much like standalone pieces. This I wanted to fit within the group a little bit more.
Look at that!
But it doesn't need it flatter. It almost needs for you to kind of go up that way.
A different direction.
Well, so that I'm seeing you go over there, not up there and coming down. That'd be better. Because then I think you've got somewhere to go. That works. That's better.
That's a much bigger amount.
Yeah, yeah.
And now we have time for
each other. Yeah. You do have to get yourself in a very different mindset for a piece like this. It's much more grounded. Nothing's ever fully stretched. Even though Kim has asked for a couple of things that are probably more authentic to me, everything is very into the ground, very fast, and the beat is incredibly important, and just looks and things like that. And I'm basically learning off the girls I'm around. I'm enjoying watching them a lot. They're just watching their little nuances, where they like touch their head or move or anything like that. It's really nice to see. I would have probably more inhibitions about things like that. It's just funny things like just putting your shoulder up. In classical ballet, we'd be very inclined to make sure the distance between your chin and your shoulder is always long. And if I did a move like that, I'd have distance. Where here, it's really happy to do sort of a roll. I think it's very much the flavor of the piece as well. Dirty. But, you know, but keeping it classy at the same time.
Yeah, so you can kind of run in. You could even run in like that.
And finally, Darcy is back on set with the ensemble of other dancers to shoot Kim's reinvention of the hugely influential The Girl Hunt with its newly commissioned score.
It was late, and it was quiet. The city breathed slowly, caught in a dream, though nightmares hid in every shadow. The name's Riley. I'm a police detective. I got a tip that something big was going down, and I wanted a piece of it. This was no place for a kid like her. She had eyes that were once bright and twice as scared. She was the girl I wanted to protect and serve forever. This wasn't what it seemed. The What was it? I guess there's only one way to find out. Checkbook, but no one could afford to make this mistake. You could cut the tension with a knife. This girl was bad. This girl was dangerous. I still had some unfinished business. The girl was bad. The girl was dangerous. But that's my kind of girl.
Soon after the bandwagon was released, rock and roll arrived, and a certain romantic innocence was lost forever.
Dance is dependent on the music, and unfortunately that type of music, the foxtrots and waltzes and the gliding glamorous dances, the music went and with it the dancing went, unfortunately.
As popular music changed, movie musicals seemed out of tune with the times, but the stars of the golden age were never outshone.
What I learned about Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly is they were geniuses, and they had set a mark incredibly high for their time on their choreographic skills and their dance ability that people are still trying to emulate today. They had such a distinctive quality of their own that they were able to create something just unique. And the detail and precision and discipline that goes behind rehearsing these numbers.
I'm happy again.
Hopefully. we got a little essence of that.
We'll be right back.